In Luke chapter 9, we see Jesus' strategy for spreading the gospel, and he chooses to work. Up to this point, who has done the preaching? Who has done the preaching? Not a trick question. He has. All right, Jesus has, right? Up to this point, when they go out, Jesus is doing the preaching. But we're about halfway through his earthly ministry. From the time he was 30, about 3 years is what he has to minister while he's on earth before he goes to the cross. We're about roughly 18 months or so into it. And so for the next 18 months, he's on the home stretch. Before we get to the end of the chapter, he makes his final journey to Jerusalem. And that's what the rest of the book of Luke speaks to. And so there's a transition time significant for Jesus here. As I mentioned, half the ministry is over. The next half is now to come. This is now the beginning, what we're going to see of active ministry. Watch this for the disciples. The mantle, so to speak, of the preaching is about to be given to his disciples. Now, he's still going to teach. He's still going to preach. And yet, he's now going to empower his disciples to share his message. And so this evening, as we see this thought, Jesus empowers his disciples, I want us to see that it's not just the 12 disciples that he empowered, but it's us today.
Amen.
It's his children today who he's also empowering to give his message to others. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. We'll jump into this passage. Thank you, Lord, for the time tonight, singing, but hearing testimonies of your working in Fiji and in our lives. Thank you for all the testimonies, giving glory to you and obeying you and giving in to you. And we certainly ask your continued blessing and working in each one of our hearts. And now, as we look in Luke 9, thank you for the word. We surrender, we submit to you and what you want to say and what you want to do in our lives. May we allow you. May we say yes, Lord. In Jesus' name. Amen. Luke chapter 9, Jesus empowers his disciples. I want us to see, first of all, number one, a divine call. A divine call. Look at it, verse number 1. Then he called his 12 disciples together and gave them power and authority over all devils and to cure diseases. And he sent them to preach the kingdom of God and to heal the sick. In this passage, Jesus, based on Matthew's account, we know who the 12 disciples are. We've seen the list of the 12 disciples a little bit earlier. Thus far, as it's used the word disciples, and even as it uses it later on, it's talking about all the followers of Jesus. But in this passage, it's singling out the 12. The 12 that we know. And as the apostles, and here they're given a divine call. Notice what they're purpose is. It's twofold. In verse number 2, he sent them to, number 1, preach the kingdom of God, and number 2, heal the sick. We'll get to those two purposes in just a moment. But these men, Jesus knows, watch this, are the foundation of the church. See, I thought Jesus was the foundation. Yes, Jesus is the rock. He's the cornerstone. But Ephesians 2:20 says, and are built upon the foundation of the apostles and prophets. Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone. Watch this. I believe Jesus knows his ministry is coming to a close soon. And so he begins to empower men to carry forth his message. He entrusts the spread of the gospel to the world to these 12 men. Now, as he gives them a divine call, I want us to see, number 1, first of all, letter A, it was accompanied with authority. As he calls them, he gives them authority. First of all, he gave them power for the mission. Notice in verse 1, it says he gave them power and authority over all devils and to cure diseases. Now, I want you to think about those two things that he gave them power over. He gave them power, it says, over all devils and to cure diseases. What chapter did we just come out of? Luke chapter 8. Okay, good. And in Luke 8, what were the last two stories that we just covered? The one we just covered last week was someone, Jairus' daughter, being healed, and the woman with an issue of blood for 12 years. What were those two things? Diseases. What was the story right before that? When he was on the boat on the other side in Galilee, there was a man that was a maniac of Gadara, demon-possessed. So Jesus just got done showing them that he has power over devils, that he has power over diseases, and now he's telling the disciples, I'm sending you out. By the way, you know that power I just showed you? I'm giving that to you now too. He's giving them authority. He just showed his power, and now he's giving them that power as well. I want you to consider this for a moment. Do you think that those men went out and used their power in order to draw people to themselves?
No.
Look at the power I've got. Everybody look at me. No. Now, if they were to do that, that'd be quite foolish. We're going to see their report a little bit later. We won't see that tonight. It's in verse 10 when they come back and they report. But they have power, but they understand that that power came from who?
Jesus.
Came from Jesus. You know, it would be like if we were to maybe go see a brand new home. And we were to admire this home and we were to say, wow, what a hammer that was used to make that house. That'd be foolish, right? Because the hammer is just simply the tool in the builder's hand. If we were to see a nice painting, we would say, my goodness, that paintbrush, let me tell you, did a wonderful work. That would be foolish of us. Why? Because all the power rests in the builder or in the artist. And may I tell you this evening, just as Jesus gave those disciples power to go forth and spread the gospel, he's given that to you and to me. You say, but I can't. Hold on. You and I are the hammer. We're the paintbrush. It's not about us anyway. However, as a tool in the master's hand, he can do something great with you. He can do something great with me. And that's what he does with these 12 apostles. Along with his power, along with his calling, I want to say this, the divine call, when he gave them a company with authority, God's calling always comes with God's enabling. May I say that again? God's calling always comes with God's enabling. I believe that God's calling me to do this, but I don't, no. If God calls, God enables. God doesn't call the qualified. We said this last week. He qualifies those who he calls. And so he calls these men to go do something. Then he gives them power to do it. The Great Commission. Jesus came and spake to them saying, all power is given who? Given unto me, Jesus said. Go ye therefore. All power is given unto me. Go ye therefore, and lo, I am with you always. Jesus said, I still have that power and authority. I'm with you. You go. You go what? Go share the good news. Share the gospel. The disciples here had power for the mission. They can overcome demonic forces as evidence of the kingdom's nearness here. I find it interesting. It's very, very clear in verse number 9, verse number 1 of chapter 9, that devils, demons, and diseases are not the same. Those who are demon-possessed and those with a disease are two different things. There's a big push that all of this has to do with some demon inside of you. Hold on. That's not scriptural whatsoever. Mm-hmm. By the way, what was their calling? Was their calling to go cast out demons? No, what was their calling? Verse number 2. And he sent them to preach the kingdom of God and to heal the sick. So he gave them power over these things. But what it was is it very clear here. They're supposed to preach the kingdom of God. And to validate their message, God gave them power to heal as well. He didn't say, go out and heal everybody. He said, go out and preach. And in doing so, I am going to validate your message with the power that I'm giving you. I believe those miraculous powers that we see here, we see some in the book of Acts as well, a transition book. I believe those were limited to the apostles. I believe these were sign gifts for the apostles. God said, I'm going to give you a message, and it's a message beyond what anyone else has heard. It's a message that's not been shared before, that the kingdom of God's at hand, that Jesus Christ is the Messiah. They've heard about it coming. They prayed for this for years, the Jews have. I want you to go and tell them it's here, that I'm him. And I'm going to validate your message with the power that I'm going to give you. Now, going forward, as the apostles passed off the scene, I believe that the sign gifts also passed away at that time. Why? You know, at this time, you don't need me to heal you so that you believe me. You don't base your belief on what I say based on what I can do. We ought to base our belief on what someone says based on what the perfect word of God it says. They did not have the full, complete word of God. They had the Old Testament law, and Jesus says, I'm here to fulfill that. And so he's giving them sign gifts. He's giving them power that accompanied their calling. Power for the mission that he gave them. Have you ever wondered, though, or is it just me? Wouldn't it be great, though, if we could have that power? You may have ever thought that? Wouldn't it be great if we were like that and we could prove this? Wouldn't it be great if God gave us power? And then I read Acts chapter 1, verse number 8. Mm-hmm. When Jesus said, but ye shall receive
power.
After that, the Holy Ghost has come upon you. Wow. We have something better than just what Jesus gave them. He gave them the power. He's given us the Holy Spirit. Why? You shall receive power. After that, the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses. That is not you get this, and then you ought to consider doing this. It's not what he said. He said, I have given you power so that you will do this. So that you and I will be witnesses unto him, Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and the uttermost parts of the earth. So there's power for the mission. There's a purpose now for the mission. I've alluded to this several times. What was the purpose? It's verse number 2. To preach the kingdom of God. Now, he had talked about the kingdom of God in last many chapters and spoken to the people. But now he's telling them, go out and preach this. Go preach the kingdom of God. He sent them. He gave them a twofold task. Preach the kingdom, heal the sick. A special time. Called on all to repent, enter the kingdom. The people who refused were to know that God's judgment was coming. Matthew 10:7, this parallel scripture, as you go, preach, saying, the kingdom of heaven is at hand. So that's their mission. A divine call. It was accompanied with authority, but it was also accompanied with instruction. Before sending them away, he gave them some specific instructions. Not just go preach, good luck, have fun. Look what their instruction is, verse 3. And he said unto them, take nothing for your journey, neither staves, nor scrip, neither bread, neither money, neither have two coats apiece. And whatsoever house ye enter into, there abide, and thence depart. And whosoever will not receive you, when you go out of that city, shake off the very dust from your feet for a testimony against them. I want you to see his calling came with some specific instructions. Here's the first one. Travel by faith. Travel light. Hey guys, you're going to go out for a while, but I don't want you to pack your bags. In fact, don't even bring an extra coat. Don't take extra weapons. Don't take extra food. Don't even take extra money. Now, wait a minute. The excitement of, we got to go out and preach and we get power, this is neat. Yeah, don't take anything with you. Wait, what? How many of you would struggle going on a trip without taking any bags? Yeah, I want to see many of you ladies' hands. You're right, all of them. I like to be extra prepared, extra do these things, and yet Jesus told them, don't take any of it. Well, what's happening? God gave them, hold on a minute, God gave them the authority. God gave them the power. And now he's saying, I'm going to give you the provision as well. The authority didn't come from you. The power is not coming from you. And your provision is not going to come from you either. I'm going to take care of it. George Mueller said this, faith does not operate in the realm of the possible. There's no glory for God in that which is humanly possible. Faith begins where man's power ends. Pastor, I can't go out and share this. I don't know this. I don't know that. Hold on. Who are we trusting in? Because when we say I can't, it kind of shows where our faith and trust is. Paul said this in Philippians 4:11, not that I speak in respect of want, for I've learned whatsoever state I am, therewith to be content. I know both how to be abased, I know how to abound. Everywhere and in all things, I'm instructed both to be full and to be hungry, both to abound and to suffer need. And he concludes that section by saying this, I can do all things through Christ, which strengtheneth me. He recognized his provision was not in his hand, it was in God's. He said unto the disciples, Luke 12, verse 22, therefore I say unto you, take no thought for your life, what ye shall eat, neither for the body, what ye shall put on. What is he trying to teach these disciples as they go and preach the kingdom of God? What's he trying to teach them? To rely on him. To not look at their ability, to not look at their preparation, to not look at what they can offer, but to trust fully what he has to offer. To trust fully in his power. This task was one of simplicity. He wanted them to travel lightly. But it was also not just to travel by faith, but to live by faith. Right. Traveling, that may be easy, but living day in and day out, he said, I want you to trust God to give you a place to sleep each night. It's as if he's telling them, I want you to trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not to your own understanding, disciples. In all your ways, acknowledge him, and he shall direct your path. We see Proverbs 3, 5, and 6 very clearly here in Luke 9. I want you to travel by faith. I want you to live by faith. And I want you to steward your time. You see, this task was one of simplicity, but it was one of urgency. It's time to go, he's telling them. And the more, watch this, the more stuff you take with you, the slower you're going to go. The more stuff you have, the more weighed down you'll be. The more stuff you have, the less urgent you can share this message. Part of the reason for traveling light was the urgency of the hour. John 9, Jesus said, I must work the works of him that sent me while it's day. The night cometh when no man can work. Ephesians 5 tells us, redeeming the time because the days are evil. He tells them in verse number 5, whosoever will not receive you when you go out of that city, shake off the very dust from your feet for a testimony against them. What in the world does that mean? For a Jew, any time they would travel, if they had to go through Gentile land, when they got out of that land back into Jewish territory, they had to dust off their feet. What are they saying? We want nothing of the Gentile going with us. Okay, we're Jews. We're leaving all of this behind. We're not taking any of them with us. They knew that. But now Jesus is saying, when you go into a city and they don't receive my message, shake off the dust of your feet. What's he saying? That's their choice. We're leaving their unbelief with them and we're moving forward with the message. If they weren't received, depart, shake the dust from their feet as a testimony against them. It warns rejectors of impending judgment. He that heareth you, heareth me, Jesus said in Luke 10. He that despiseth you, despiseth me. And he that despiseth me, despiseth him that sent me. Please hear, here's what Jesus is telling them, is what he's telling us as well. In this life, we ought to travel lightly. If we're not careful, while we're in this world that's not our home, we'll be weighed down by stuff. You know what that stuff does? It limits your ability to give his message. that stuff in our life just completely consumes our time, completely consumes our energy and our focus. And now, rather than giving the message, we're weighed down by stuff. Pastor, I could never go on a mission trip. Hold on a minute. Which world is our home? We've got to take the message. It's an urgent time. And Jesus said it ought to be a simple time. Trust me. I've given you a calling. I've given you authority. I've given you power. I'll give you provision. It's amazing to me that as Christians, we can trust God with our eternity, but we can't trust Him for today. That's amazing faith that we can put our eternity in His hands and know beyond a shadow of a doubt we're on our way to heaven. Praise the Lord for that truth. But you can't rely on Him to provide for you today? Jesus said, maybe you're weighed down a little too much. Travel by faith, live by faith, steward your time. There's a divine call. I love this. Number two, briefly, there's a direct consent. The disciples obeyed. Watch what happened, verse 6. And they departed. I love this. You know, we don't see between verses 5 and 6. Jesus, I've got questions. Now, maybe they did. Maybe it just didn't record that. But how's this going to work? Jesus said, go. I'll give you the power. I'll give you the authority. Here's your instructions. And they departed and went through the towns, preaching the gospel and healing everywhere. Direct obedience. Someone said that delayed obedience is disobedience. When God has called us, when God has given us direction, it's best for us to say, yes, sir, right away. They didn't question. They didn't offer their suggestions. They obeyed Him directly and without reservation. In Acts 5, I mentioned this passage last week. The men were that had arrested Peter and the disciples, Peter and John specifically, for preaching. They said, did not we straitly command you that ye should not teach in this name? And behold, you fill Jerusalem with your doctrine and intend to bring this man's blood upon us? Then Peter and the other apostles answered and said, we ought to obey God rather than men. We ought to obey God rather than men. Charles Spurgeon, I love this quote. He said, I believe that the happiest of all Christians, the truest of Christians, are those who never dare to doubt God, but take His word simply as it stands, believe it, and ask no questions, just feeling assured that if God has said it, it will be so. I believe all of us in our hearts believe that. If God said it, it will be so. Yet how many of us act on that and go forward with that? The disciples, there's a direct consent. There's a direct obedience. There's a dynamic message. They were tasked with preaching the gospel of the kingdom of God in every city they went to. If I'm them, I've been learning from Jesus for a year and a half. I don't know about you, but I remember in many of these stories, they had some questions. I've seen them in previous chapters fail in their faith. I mean, just the chapter before, they were asking Jesus, are we going to die?
Yeah.
And now He's sending them out. If I'm then, I'm thinking, are you sure I'm ready? You know me, I was the one that questioned you just a little while ago, and now you're giving me the authority and the power to preach your message? I think it's too much for me. I'm going to let you do that. That's not what they said. They just obeyed. Paul said, for I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first, also to the Greek. The miracles that they did served witness to the validity of their message. You always see it in that order. A divine call, a direct consent. And then we have an interesting twist as we conclude this evening. We see a distress concern. They're all over the Galilean region. It's what it seems is where they've all been, all 12. It says in verse 7, now Herod the Tetrarch heard of all that was done by him. And he was perplexed, because it was said of some that John was risen from the dead. And of some that Elias had appeared. And of others that one of the old prophets was risen again. And Herod said, John have I beheaded. But who's this of whom I hear such things? And he desired to see him. So it seems as though the disciples have obeyed. They've gone out and shared the message. And really what I gather from this odd few verses here is that this message has gone forth abroad so many ways that it's even reached to the government levels. 12 people are making such a difference that the guy in charge hears all about it. Don't think that they're just going out into one little small town here and six people over here, and there's tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands, perhaps, of people, and two or three are hearing about it, and two or three. It seems as though they're getting the message out. How could they do that? Obviously, they had the power of Jesus to do so. But word is quickly spreading around everywhere, so much that Herod the Tetrarch, what does that mean, the Tetrarch? Remember, Tetra means four. Herod's dad had way too much power, and was put there in charge by the Romans. And after he died, they split that area up into four sections, Tetrarch being four. And so the Galilean region was Herod, which was one of the sons of Herod. Herod Antipas here is in charge of this Galilean region. And he gets word, something's happening up here. Something's happening in all these cities. There's a message of this Jesus. May I tell you, even today, the more we spread God's word, the more there will be of people who feel threatened.
Yeah.
Herod felt threatened by the ministry of Jesus. He was perplexed. He was the ruler of Galilee. He received news, the progress, the development of Jesus' movement, that they were performing miracles as they were preaching the kingdom. I would imagine he feels threatened. Wait a minute, someone's saying something and doing miracles? And then he starts thinking back to John. Remember John, John the Baptist? Remember what he did a few chapters earlier? After John the Baptist had preached directly to him and told him he shouldn't have the wife that he had and he was living in adultery and all of that. And what did Herod do to John the Baptist? We already know this. He had him beheaded. And then perhaps he's thinking about that. In fact, it says, John have I beheaded. He's wondering, did John rise from the grave? The Jews all talk about the prophets living again. Is this Elijah? What's going on? Some thought he was John. Some thought he was Elijah. Some thought he was a prophet. A prophet of old returning. That was common in Judaism, by the way. Prophets were suggested to be returning, including Moses. Moses, Jeremiah, Isaiah, you can see it in different portions in the old passages of the Old Testament. We won't take time and look at it in that way. But we see Herod he's kind of wondering what's going on. Everyone's hearing about it. He had beheaded John the Baptist, and maybe it was a guilty conscience that is calling him, but now he wants to see him. I hear such things at the end of verse 9, and he desired to see him. What I see in Herod is what I see in a lot of people today. And if we're not careful, it can be in each one of us. What is it? We see the notoriety of Jesus. We perhaps have some curiosity of Jesus. We certainly see what Jesus can do. Maybe we're interested in the novelty of what comes about those who are around Jesus. And we want to see him. Herod, a few chapters later, I think it's chapter 12 and verse 30. It's somewhere there. We see that Herod gets word and he wants to kill Jesus now. And Jesus sends back a message saying, this and this and this and this are happening. These people are being healed, and these people are hearing, and these people are believing. Tell Herod that. And we don't see Herod again for about a year and a half. And now Jesus is going to be crucified. And he's brought before the Sanhedrin and the council. And then he's brought before Pilate. And Pilate wants nothing to do with it. You know the story. And Pilate said, wait a minute. Herod is in town. Why would he send him to Herod? Because Herod's the tetrarch over Galilee. And Jesus is from up there. Why don't you go send him to him? And you know what it said that Herod did? When Jesus came, Herod got excited. Why? Because he finally gets to see Jesus. And you know what it said he did? He was hoping that Jesus would do a miracle for him. Here Jesus about to be crucified, sent before Herod. We see it all the way back in Luke chapter 9. Ooh, that'd be neat. I want to see this Jesus. Maybe he can do something great for me. Please hear me. We'll conclude. He wasn't interested in the message of Christ. He was interested in the help from Jesus. He wasn't interested in the kingdom of heaven. He was interested in the miracles that he could get now. And there's a lot of people today, and if we're not careful, this is us. We know Jesus has power. We read about it. We see it. We may even want to sit in the church and experience that for ourselves. Wouldn't that be cool to see this? Meanwhile, we don't really believe his message. We don't really want to see the kingdom of heaven in our lives. We just want to see what Jesus can do for me. In Herod, there's a danger for believers. Are we going to see the urgency of the message? Or are we just going to be interested in the novelty of it? The same command this evening that Jesus gave his disciples to preach the gospel is given to us today. We mentioned this earlier as they were given testimonies on the missions trip. They were given this and they went to do this and the team all worked together. I could never do that. You're right, you couldn't. Neither could the disciples. And yet Jesus said, I'm giving you power to do it. I'm giving you authority to do it. It's not your message anyway, he's telling them. You're just the tool that's used in my hand. I am choosing to use you to get the message out. Thus far, Jesus has done the preaching. Jesus has done the teaching. Now he's saying, going forward, I want you to. I want you to get the gospel out. I'm entrusting this powerful, life-changing, world-needing message to you 12 men. I'm giving you power to validate that message. And then Jesus leaves. He's crucified. He rises again. He ascends into heaven. And he looks at them. And today, he looks at us. And he says, I've got a message still. Let me give you power to share it. Oh, not power for everybody to look at you, but the power of the Holy Spirit to tell someone else. Mm-hmm. I can't do that. Well, hold on. It's not about you, Jesus says. It's all about me. It's my message anyway. It's my hope that you can give anyway. Are you going to trust me? But what about this? No. Don't take with you staves or script or money. Trust me to provide. Well, that doesn't make sense. Hold on. I'll take care of you. I'll give you a place to stay. If someone doesn't accept it, move on. Don't get so bogged down that they didn't accept it that we're not even going to share it anymore. No, shake off the dust of your feet and move on to the next one. What if they don't hear? He's already counted on it that some won't hear. We don't let it stop us. Continue going forward with the message. As we look in Luke 9, 1 through 9, we see that Jesus empowered his disciples to begin getting the message out. And we see that today. Jesus has empowered us. Let's go with the gospel. Let's bow our heads and hearts together in prayer this evening. Thank you so much for listening.